Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
So I'm very happy to have our next speaker here, all the way from sunny California, Rachel, which is going to tell us about long-standing open problem, concurrent zero knowledge in a constant number of rounds.
Thank you. Yeah, it's nice coming back here, especially from... I cannot say that it's not sunny here. Look outside how sunny it is, especially with all the snow, it reflects the light. But I think... thanks for inviting me. It's really nice to be back here. I miss Boston a lot. Yeah. So today I'm going to talk about three things: concurrent zero knowledge, delegation, and indistinguishability of obfuscation. Okay, someone already say, really? So nowadays there are those like random generators for titles of cryptography papers. Basically, pick some like keywords, hot topic, and then put them together probabilistically. So this almost looked like something that could be generated with high probability. But the goal of the talk today is that I want to convince you that I didn't generate this title at random. In fact, there's some story about them. And here's the story in one slide. We're going to look at, this is going to be about the tale of this concurrent zero knowledge. And zero knowledge itself is a very fascinating concept, definitely mesmerizing. I think many people, when seeing it for the first time, get very fascinated. How can something like that be formalized and defined? And concurrent zero knowledge is just a natural extension of it. And what makes it even more fascinating is the fact that for a very, very long time, we really didn't have any constant construction for it. In contrary to most of the cryptographic primitives, where we get constant round construction by fairly quickly, it doesn't withstand a lot of effort. But this is not the case for concurrent zero knowledge. Another reason it's very mesmerizing because from a technique point of view, zero knowledge and concurrent zero knowledge are inherently about simulation, from the definition to the technique. And simulation is really very fundamental in cryptography, and it's really the bread and butter for achieving a lot of cryptographic goals. And therefore, it's interesting to see advances or new techniques for doing simulation. And in fact, concurrent zero knowledge is one place where really constantly we see barriers of simulation, especially black box, and has the track record of inventing new simulation techniques. Not so much for a lot other primitive. They're interesting for, obviously, other reasons. That's why I am very fascinated by getting constant round concurrent zero knowledge. And over the years, recently, there have been some advances, which I will also mention in the talk. And the story today is that constant round concurrent zero knowledge can actually be reduced to what we call this some special purpose delegation of P. Well, delegation of computation in P is just cares about the verification of the correctness of the output. Okay. So it's something that doesn't care about zero knowledge, it cares about soundness, and it doesn't care about NP, it cares about only P. But it turns out that it's sufficient for constant round CDK. And then we're going to show that, in fact, this special purpose delegation can be instantiated using I.O. Okay. All right, so some basics. Zero knowledge. That's right. Of course. Not surprising, right? It's like not surprising. Maybe the story will be more surprising if I don't show the latter part. But I think most of the talk is actually going to be about the top part, that how to use the delegation to solve CDK. Yeah. Okay. There are knowledge proofs. Okay, there are those paradoxical constructs that allows a prover to convince a verifier about the correctness of a statement without revealing anything beyond the validity. Okay, and there's lots of applications for it, and the most notable ones including identification protocols that allow someone to prove about its identity, his or her identity, associated with a public key by proving that he knows about the corresponding secret key. And of course, now the zero knowledge property is very important because you don't want to reveal the secret key. And also, a very generic technique I've been using zero knowledge over and over again, which is a generic technique for ensuring honesty, where usually typical use is after every step of an arbitrary protocol for other applications, is the participants are going to be required to give a zero knowledge proof about the fact that he generated a message correctly with respect to some secret random coin without revealing those secret random coins. Okay. So the zero knowledge property, as I said, is inherently about the simulation. It requires that in order to formalize the sentence saying that the verifier really learns nothing, we require that there exists a simulator that can just output the view of the of the verifier in an indistinguishable way to the real view of the verifier when talking to an honest prover. So the view, we all know that includes both the random coins together with all the messages, and therefore the output of the simulator is also going to be a set of random coins together with all the messages. And in order for this paradigm to make sense, the intuitive meaning of simulation is that whatever the verifier can see is sort of what can be generated using only the statement itself. Therefore, it cannot learn anything beyond the statement. For this sentence to make sense, we must make sure that the simulator doesn't run too much longer than the verifier himself. And we usually care about the ratio between the running time of the simulator and the running time of the verifier, because that sort of characterizes the knowledge tightness. But generically, we just care about the simulator runs in time polynomial in the verifier's running time. Okay. So what do we know about zero knowledge? We know that everything provable is provable in zero knowledge, and assuming only one-way function. And in fact, over the years, there's a lot of constructions of zero knowledge protocols. There are very efficient ones that are even implementable now. But most of these are only considering the standalone setting, where we consider one set of parties executing a single run of the protocol. But of course, life is concurrent. I'm surprised that not so many of you are doing that, but some of you may be listening to my talk and having another conversation with someone else through the internet. So this is concurrency in life. Cannot restrict the people to pay attention to only one thing anymore in today's world. And this is particularly prevalent in the digital world. And there could be many sets of parties running many protocol executions, and some of the adversary could be launching a coordinated attack. And this is sort of the motivation for studying concurrent zero knowledge, where we want to characterize what a verifier could learn by performing a coordinated attack on many proofs that he simultaneously receives. And in this setting, we want to give the verifier the most power that he can have. And in particular, we will allow the verifier to schedule the message in all those different sections of proofs that he is simultaneously receiving in arbitrary manner that he wants. Okay? This is important, and in fact, this is one fact that makes zero knowledge or simulation in general very hard in this setting. Okay. But again, for zero knowledge, the property, what we want is that the simulator can now not only simulate individual sessions of the proofs, but also simultaneously the entire conversation the verifier is receiving with multiple provers. And we want to say that as long as simulator can generate those views in an indistinguishable way without knowing anything about the witness in particular and only learns about the statement, then it sort of intuitively says that the verifier learns nothing beyond the statement. All right, so. How do we usually achieve zero knowledge protocols? Now I'm going to start to kind of go into the construction of general zero knowledge and try to morph them into construction of concurrent zero knowledge. And along the way, we're going to see some barriers. So a classical zero knowledge protocol usually is somewhat counterintuitive because it usually contains some kind of, so as I said, zero knowledge is all about the simulation. Okay, therefore, the construction of those protocols is all about enabling simulation. Therefore, you're going to see in the protocol some preambles which is seemingly completely irrelevant to proving the statement. And these are usually used so that the verifier can sort of implant a trapdoor that could be later exploited by the simulator in order to cheat. So here is an example how this can be done. This is a very beautiful protocol by Feige and Shamir. Usually we call this style of protocol the Feige-Shamir paradigm. Here we are going to ask the verifier to commit to a random secret sigma, and he's going to give you some slots, some messages to show his knowledge of this sigma. And afterwards, the prover is going to use a WI proof to show that either the statement is true or he knows sigma. Okay? In some ways, it follows just because that the preamble is designed to be hiding of the random sigma. Therefore, a cheating prover is not supposed to learn anything about sigma and is forced to prove the validity of the forced to prove the validity of the statement. On the other hand, what should the simulator do? The simulator must have some power that the cheating prover doesn't have. And in simulation, the most basic technique is rewinding. That is the superpower the simulator has that the cheating prover doesn't have. Therefore, the simulator could just rewind this slot of knowledge. Therefore, by rewinding, extract the secret. And now he has a fake witness for convincing the verifier in the WI. Okay. But unfortunately, this black box rewinding beautiful technique somehow doesn't scale with the number of sessions. And here's the reason why. When the verifier could choose to get multiple proofs, and in particular, he could arbitrarily interleave the message in the order he wants, here's a very hard order for us to handle. In particular, he's going to completely nest all those proofs, one inside another. Okay, so let's try the previous trick again. The simulator, in order to simulate the outermost session, is going to try to rewind the slot of knowledge in that session. But when he does that, in the rewinding, he will have to also create all the messages for the verifier of those inner sessions in order for the verifier to give a reply to complete the outer slot of knowledge. But that means that every time when he rewinds, he will have to redo all the work to simulate all the nested sessions, which means rewinding those sessions again. And as you can see that, it can easily take time exponential in the number of nestings. And this is not hard for the verifier to do at all, because you just need a polynomial number of sessions and place them in this specific scheduling. So what is the way out? The way out is very intuitive. Richardson and Killian proposed to say, well, if the problem is nesting, then we can try to design the protocol that makes it harder for the adversary to nest. Particularly if you have more slots of knowledge, that indeed make it harder for the verifier to try to nest for each of the slots. Because in order to do that, he will need to use a lot of sessions. And that sort of place, you can view this as a sort of a game between the verifier and the protocol designer. And indeed, if you have more slots, you can prove that simulation using rewinding works again. Here, yeah. So the first work, excellent question. Richardson and Killian proved that n to the epsilon number of slots suffice. And this is improved by Killian and Petrunk to log square n. And then later, using the same simulation as the KP simulator, but with a better analysis, the PRS work actually showed that we only need omega log n number of slots. And this is a very beautiful work. And it turns out that log n is essentially tight with respect to black box simulator. So the CKPR showed that if you want to have a black box simulatable concurrent zero knowledge, then the number of rounds cannot go lower than log n over log log n. Okay. But on a slightly different direction, but still sort of the same theme, is that as you can see that the number of slots is inherently tied with the running time of the simulator. The more slots there is, the easier for the simulator to simulate. And PV showed that using three slots, which is a small number, you can actually get a simulation that takes quasi-polynomial time instead of polynomial time. And in fact, there is a very general lower bound that extends CKPR that shows that this is also tight. So there is inherently some... Exactly. Except that the number of slots is smaller. Yeah. And then you need to rewind. When you rewind, you need to make sure that the sort of the nesting is not more than kind of polylogarithmic. And you can show that. There must, even if there are only three slots, there must be one slot, the nesting is smaller than polylog. Therefore, as you can see that over the years, there's a very nice buildup or suspension that kind of is asking whether there is a constant round CDK protocol. Of course, this problem is solved given some trusted setup. More or less everything is solved with the trusted setup, and this is not the focus of this talk. Okay, so as we see that CDK is one place where black box simulation hits a limit. In not so many places we have this limit, that's why it makes it interesting and forces us to look for new simulation techniques. And a beautiful work by Barak that showed that there is actually a constant round bounded concurrent zero knowledge protocol using a very new technique, which by now not very new standard, but at that point it was really a breakthrough, the non-black box simulation technique. And notice that bounded concurrent zero knowledge, we didn't know how to do before. And in fact, the CKPR lower bound also works for bounded concurrent zero knowledge. I forgot to say what it is. It just means that there is a priori bound on the number of concurrent sessions the verifier could receive. And your protocol could depend on this bound. Okay. So this already kind of breaks one limitation of black box zero knowledge. And this kind of is the dawn of there was a lot of excitement. Okay, now we have this new technique. What can we do with it? Maybe it is just there that we can get constant round CDK. But it turns out it's not the case. And there's also some difficulty in adapting Barak's technique into the fully concurrent setting, which I will talk about later. And until maybe like in 2013, when the knowledge assumption started to gain again lots of attention in the community, that people formulated that if we can have some very strong knowledge assumption, in particular, let's just assume that in the Feige-Shamir protocol, this preamble where we commit to this secret is concurrently extractable, then yes, you can get a concurrent simulation. But this is a very strong assumption because the fact that these preambles are concurrently extractable is assumed. Yes, it's assumed, yeah. It doesn't need to be straight line extractable. Yeah, just exist and extract. Exactly. So, but sure, but it's somewhat unsatisfactory, this as an answer, because the simulation uses this non-explicit extractor, therefore the simulation itself is also non-explicit. And as I said, a lot of kind of beauty of CDK is about the simulation itself. If the simulator is non-explicit, it kind of loses the point. But of course, that's technical reasons. And in in 2013, with Kaimi and Rafael Paz, we gave a constant round to CDK using a new assumption called the P certificate, okay, which I will talk about later. In short, it is a very succinct, non-interactive proof system for polynomial time computation. And after that, lately, with the explosion of obfuscation works, there is a new construction of CDK from different inputs I/O, together with some other. I'm ignoring the rest because compare. And this work is actually very interesting because although different input I/O itself is a knowledge assumption, it assumes that if one can distinguish two obfuscated program, then one can there exists an extractor that can output a different input for those two circuits. Although itself is a knowledge assumption, what's different between this work? What's different between this work and the previous knowledge assumption is that the work using DIO actually only used the knowledge assumption in order to prove soundness. On the other hand, for simulation, they still build an explicit simulator. Therefore, the simulation doesn't rely on the extractability assumption at all. Okay? That makes it much more interesting. I think their original work used the DIO, but then the new public coin DIO showed that you can recover this result using only public coin DIO. Yeah. But yeah, you're right. You're sort of working on the edge. So therefore, now in a very recent new work, we show that you can actually get constant round CDK from only IO. Okay, so to answer Tao's question, of course, IO is a very strong assumption itself, and it more or less implies everything. I just want to say that in light of the CDK, it might still be interesting because all the other works are also very strong assumptions. Yeah. All right, so what I'm going to do in the rest, I will try to give an overview of both of these works together.
The only reason you need IO here is to build feature. Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
So
yeah.
It's not really IO. It's a P.
Right. I really view it as more P certificate.
So you show the P certificates are applied by IO.
Yes.
And then you use the
You need to have some like extra work because not exact. The previous P certificate we can't instantiate. So we have to weaken, relax the P certificate notion, and then we can instantiate. All right. So now, a little bit more specific, we're going to show that constant round CDK reduces down what we call unique delegation for P. Okay, this is something new that we didn't talk about before and is going to become clear very soon. Basically, it says that the proof of correctness is unique given the statement. And it can be instantiated using I/O. Okay. So the outline, yeah, of course, please. The theorem says that we can get a constant CDK from IO plus one permutation and a collision resistant hash function. And we actually need, okay, so this is actually an important point. We actually need the IO and the one-way permutation to be slightly super-polynomially hard. So they need to be secure, withstand adversaries running in some super polynomial function, but not quasi polynomial, not specific. No. Any n to the omega 1. Anything that is super polynomial.
Okay.
Computable?
Any adversary, essentially, any adversary. She wants IO.
No, it's important because if it's not efficiently computable, then the standard thing is already there. If it is efficiently computable, it's a new assumption. If it's not, then it's polysecure heavy.
What's efficiently?
You mean the obfuscation?
N to the log star n is efficiently computable. you can think of super polynomial that are not efficiently computed.
Oh, I see. Okay, so any n to the omega 1 in particular, those efficient computable ones are fine. Does that answer your question?
No.
Okay. All right, so what I'm going to go through is that I'll first tell you about what is this unique delegation, which we call unique P certificate. And then we're going to construct constant random knowledge from it. And now what's important is that, in fact, the unique P certificate is something really, really strong, sort of gives the point of how uniqueness could be used to help simulation in CDK, but this is something too strong. We don't know how to instantiate. So a lot of the work, not going to be the focus of the talk today, but in the paper, we try to relax unique P certificate first to the CRS model. And we show that in the CRS model, you can already implement it using DIO. Therefore, in some sense that you can recover the result of constant round CDK from DIO as a special case of this technique. And then we're going to further relax it to unique two-round P certificate, not in the CRS model. Two-round basically means that the first message depends on the statement instead of like a CRS that doesn't depend on the statement. And then we can show that this can be instantiated using IO. And it relies on a very recent and beautiful work by, I don't remember the name of the first author, KRW14. Let's just not mention. All right, P certificates. In short, they're non-interactive, very succinct argument for polynomial time computation. And the statement could look like this, that I want to prove a machine on some input is going to produce some output in some polynomial number of steps in the length of the input. Okay? And because it's non-interactive, it only involves the prover sending one message to the verifier, and that's all, non-interactive. And it has to be very succinct in the sense that the length of the input is something independent of neither the size of your machine nor the running time of the machine. Okay? And it is just something that is short, fixed polynomial length, okay, in the security parameter. And in terms of the prover and the verifier efficiency, the running time of the verifier, since the input to the verifier is the statement together with the proof, it has to run in time polynomial in the length of the machine. Okay? And the running time of the prover, obviously, has to depend on the complexity of the machine. So we rely on the running time of the machine. So it is important that the verifier is relatively efficient. It only depends on the size of the machine, but not the complexity. And in some sense, you can view it as this primitive that says polynomial time computation could be verified in a fixed polynomial time instead of instead of depending on the complexity of the statement. And we're particularly interested in those type of P certificates that are unique. Unique in the sense that for every true statement, there is exactly one accepting proof. It's not computational. Unique is something unconditional. Yeah. In fact, we want to say for every statement, there is at most one proof that will be accepting. And if it's a false statement, no proof will be accepting. No, just no. There's just no proof that's accepting. So uniqueness is a very strong property. It's unconditional. It's not just that it is hard to find one. In some sense, yes.
But that makes it a proof.
Yeah, that makes a proof. Okay, so
M is deterministic too, right?
M is deterministic, yeah. Oh, okay, okay, you're right, you're right. So there is no that restriction. For every statement, there is at most one proof that could be accepting. If it's a true statement, then the prover functionality helps you to efficiently find such a proof. If it's a false statement, then it is hard for any efficient prover to find such a proof. Yeah, right.
Okay, but so let me just make sure I understand. So but even the uniqueness says that efficiently, so unless, so the only way to generate two accepting proofs is by breaking the assumption. So it's not like there does not exist.
No. Uniqueness is unconditional.
Uniqueness is unconditional. It's
yeah.
False,
yeah.
Even put at most one.
So
at
yeah.
Okay. But the uniqueness being unconditional is important.
Yes, exactly. It's important. It's going to be important. Yeah. Any statement, there is at most one proof that's accepting with respect to it, and it's just that. We know that for true statement, it's easy to find. For false statements, it might exist, but it's hard to find. But even no matter which cases, even if it exists, there's only one.
So is there a setup phase? Is this unique with respect to a common random string or something?
Yes, when we relax it to the common reference string model, then uniqueness with respect to the statement and the common reference string. And when we even relax it for two round P certificate, then it's also unique with respect to statement and the first message. Okay. So as you can see, this is a very strong assumption. Okay? P certificate is strong already. Uniqueness is something that's like adding more. So do P certificate actually exist? When we did the first paper in 2013, we instantiated the P certificate using Macaulay's Sears proof in the random oracle model. And you can make the assumption that if there exists a hash function that can securely instantiate the random oracle for the Sears proofs, then it gives you a P certificate. It's non-interactive. It has two drawbacks. One drawback is that actually any non-interactive, in particular, for Michaelis CS proof, we know that even for false statement, there exist verifying proofs, okay? And there exist more than one. So first of all, it's obviously not unique. And second of all, because for false statement, there also exist false accepting proof, the soundness is only against the uniform cheating provers. In the non-interactive, it's always, yeah. So this is... But you could also make the type of assumption that cheating statement, there exists a P certificate for which cheating statement doesn't have any accepting proof. Which is going to be an even stronger assumption. That's why I cannot just say the sentence that any non-interactive P certificate can only be sound against uniform adversary. Because I can make that assumption, which is very strong and likely not true, but we don't know. Okay. Yes. Yes.
We believe the opposite.
Yeah.
We don't have a proof. I mean.
Yes. Well, whereas for NP, you have
a. It's like you can assume NP is equal to P. It's not. We don't know it's false. We just believe it's not okay. So it's not as strong.
So like P is non-deterministic at time or something.
Exactly.
Yeah. All of
it's
Yeah, there are those like de-randomization assumptions. That's exactly the opposite of what you want for like P proofs. Okay, so that's obviously a very strong assumption. That's why in the previous paper, the bulk of the paper is actually about how to handle kind of non-uniqueness. And I sort of went a different direction. This is where the current paper kind of a fork. And the current paper just sort of went along with uniqueness. But let's say that if I relax the non-interactive requirement, the first is to look at P certificate in the CRS model. And I still want it to be unique. Now uniqueness will be with respect to the CRS. And we're going to only use the static soundness. And in fact, for this, we have a construction using DIO because DIO implies obfuscation of tooling machines. And then one can simply set the CRS to be the obfuscation of this universal tooling machine that is going to take as input the entire P statement I want to prove, do the computation internally, and check whether the output is correct, and then sign the entire statement in a unique way. OK, so I want to point out that in order for this to work, I actually need a very, very strong obfuscation that it's not only succinct with respect to the complexity of the machine, it also needs to be succinct with respect to the size of the machine.
Sorry, why do you want the CRS to be small?
Because you're going to generate it as a part of the protocol.
Okay.
And anything inside the protocol needs to be fixed to polynomial length.
I see.
Yeah. OK. And we can actually even further weaken the P certificate notion to the two-round unique P certificate, where the only difference is that the first message is not the CRS anymore and could in particular depend on the statement, and its computation could also depend on the statement. And this we can construct from IO. And in fact, we can actually show that we didn't write in the paper, but you can extend it further. It doesn't need to be two rounds. It could be any number of rounds, as long as all the heavy messages, in the sense messages that are computationally expensive to compute, that will depend, or the proven message that will have time that depends on the complexity of the statement, is unique. Okay, so it could be a unique interactive P certificate. It's not going to be certificate anymore. It's so you can, I'm just saying, you can generalize the unique P certificates to multiple rounds. And yeah, we don't know. And that's why we also don't go into that. Yeah, two round IO already give you two round, and we don't know any if by adding more rounds whether it can help us to reduce the assumption. Okay, so now I'm gonna start try to first tell you how to use. I'm gonna go in steps, tell you how to use the very strong unique P certificate, and then how to go down to those weaker versions.
By the way, just on the previous
yeah?
Slides, these two results would also give you like NP certificates, right? Or no, or they're really, I know you only
this need definitely give you NP certificate, DIO. From IO, I don't think it give you NP certificate. Maybe from like a exponentially hard IO, it can give you NP certificate because you were yeah. From IO, there's still the problem. So okay, so both IO and DIO can now give you a obfuscation of tooling machine. There's one difference that this from DIO, it's really, really short, independent of the input. And from IO, it still depends on the input. Therefore, your proof is going to depend on the statement length as well as the witness length if you talk about NP. And this is and this requires some like extra work to handle. All right. Okay, in order to talk about how to get CDK from unique P certificate, I need to first tell you Bragg's protocol, which is very beautiful. And as usual, it consists of a preamble that is there for the purpose of implant a trapdoor, and then it follows from a WI. And here, the preamble is very simple. It consists of a commitment and a random challenge from the verifier. The key point here is the random challenge has to be very long. Okay. And then the prover needs to prove that either the statement is true or he has built up a trapdoor. So what is the trapdoor here? Slightly complicated is that the commitment he commits to is actually not a commitment to zero, but actually to a machine. And this machine, on a very small input, very short input, will output the random challenge the verifier sent. And this is called the fake witness. In order for the whole thing to work, I'm going to make some simplifying assumption. One is that the commitment is compressing. it doesn't depend on the length. The length of the commitment is independent of the length of the value it commits to. And the second is that also the WI universal argument is compressing. Therefore, I'm going to just assume for now that all the messages, the total length of the prover message is n. So the total length of the commitment together with WI is n. And you can do that. So why is this protocol sound? It is sound by a very beautiful argument. It's because that if a cheating prover wants to cheat, he must set up the trapdoor. But how can he do that? Because he needs to commit to the machine before the verifier sends a random challenge. And at that point, he has no idea about what that very long challenge is going to be. But he has to commit to a machine that, given a very short input, is going to predict it. The output of the machine, the number of possible outputs, is determined by the length of the short input, which is much, much smaller than the possible choice of the random challenge the verifier could choose from. Another way you can think about it is that once a machine is fixed after committing, doesn't have any entropy. However, on a very small input that has at most n bits of entropy, the machine needs to output predict something that has 2n bits of entropy. Therefore, information theoretically, it's impossible. And that's why soundness holds. But zero knowledge becomes very easy. Why? Because remember that to show simulation, we always need to say the simulator has some superpower that the cheating prover doesn't have. And this superpower here is that the simulator knows about the code of the verifier, including its random coins. It can just set its random coins. Therefore, the simulator could just commit to a machine that is the verifier himself. And the input to this machine is going to be the commitment. And by definition, this verifier, after receiving the commitment, is going to output the random string. Therefore, the simulator could set up such a verifying fake statement, fake witness. OK. And in fact, as you see that the crucial point that is leveraged in this argument is that the input to the verifier is way shorter than the output of the verifier. Okay? And as long as this is true, one can always use the Bragg's protocol. Therefore, the Bragg protocol naturally extends to k-bounded concurrency. Because we know the prover messages are short, as long as the number of concurrent sections is bounded by k, the total number of input to the verifier has bounded length. In particular, be kn. And I just need to set the length of the random challenge, which is the output of the verifier, to be longer than that. And we're going to see this very briefly. And I will demonstrate how this works using a particular nesting scheduling. And for save of space, you're going to see that I'm going to put everything sequentially. So what happens is the verifier is going to get all the commitment at the beginning. And then each of the sessions is going to start to complete sequentially. Therefore, they are all nested one after the other. OK. What the simulator wants to do is, like in Bragg, he will commit to the code of the verifier in every session. Now, in the ith session, when he wants to complete the WI, he wants to cheat, he must prove that the machine, which is the verifier he commits to, on some input is going to output the random challenge in that session, which is Ri. So the question is how to set the input. Well, we want the simulation, the fake witness, to be a tautology, which is by definition is true. Therefore, I just set the input to be everything that the verifier receives up to he sends Ri. If I do that, then by definition, the fake witness is true. And I need to now calculate to make sure that the input of the machine is shorter than the output of the machine. And this is also true because I've already set the random challenge to be longer than the total length of the prover message. So definitely it's going to be much longer than Ti. So unfortunately, as you see that this paradigm does not extend to the fully concurrent setting, because I really want to have, I really want to build up this gap between the length of the challenge from the verifier and the length of the prover message. Okay? And if there is an unbounded number of sessions, there is absolutely no bound in the length of the prover message. And therefore, there is no way that I can set the challenge length unless it's super polynomial. Yeah?
I don't think about concurrence to your knowledge very much. So the question I have is a basic one. Uh-huh. In terms of the instantiation of the instances. Right? So who decides which pair of parties is going to be running an instance of this protocol? I mean, you could have the verifier, you know, starting, let's say I'm going to go to some new bank and start a new protocol as a consequence of it. And so the mere counterpart, set of counterparties that he's dealing with is dynamically determined in real life.
Yes.
What's already happened. I just want to make sure I understand that aspect of the modeling.
So if the counterparty is honest, it's without loss of generality to just think about they're all running the honest prover code. It's without loss of generality to think about there's as if there's a single party running all the honest prover code. Because in the zero knowledge setting, the verifier is always supposed to receive messages from the honest prover. Right. So as long as you can have a single verifier that's talking to different parties. Yeah, but as long as they're all honest, there's no difference whether they're different parties or they're the same party running the honest code. It can be at least emulated by a single party running the honest code multiple times independently. Okay. So what can we do in unbounded concurrency? Okay, fine. This method of sort of like bounding the length of the machine is kind of doomed in this setting. Therefore, people started to think about new ways. Okay, what is a new way? Maybe one new way is to see that really, I mean, in the simulation, the verifier is not receiving arbitrary messages, right? The verifiers are receiving simulated prover messages from the simulator. Therefore, I actually really know about how those messages are simulated or how those messages are generated. So instead of saying that the verifier needs to receive those messages as input, how about I just commit to both the simulator and the verifier or add together? And therefore, for this machine, there's really no input. Okay? Suddenly it becomes there's no input. And there's still output, which are those challenges, which is good for us because we want to have this gap between the length of input and the length of the output. So let's try this, okay? This was a folklore idea and kind of circled around the community for many years. And of course, okay, so what we want to do is now we want the simulator to, instead of commit to the verifier's code, he's going to commit to both the simulator, his own code, together with the verifier code. So this already sounds a little bit paradoxical because I don't even know if a machine could output its own code, right? Definitely a circuit cannot. A circuit cannot output its own circuit, right? Description. So there's some circularity issue that needs to be dealt with, but it is fine as long as I view the simulator itself as a tooling machine. I'm not going to talk about the detail here, but this can be done. So the simulator is going to commit to himself together with the verifier. And now, in a WI, in the I session, he wants to prove that the simulator himself and the verifier, on no input, is going to output the challenge in the I session. Which is correct, because this is a tautology again. Indeed, the challenge is generated inside the simulator and the verifier. Okay? Except that, oddly enough, somehow the exponential blow-up that we saw in the black box setting come back to haunt us in this setting again. Why? Let's take a look at the running time of the simulation. And I'm going to look at the running time of the simulator up to simulating the I plus 1 the challenge is generated, okay, to R I plus 1. Definitely, that would include the part for the simulator to simulate up to the ice challenge is generated to Ri, together with the time used for generating the Wi. in the ith session. Okay? But if we think about what is this wi in the ith session proving about, it is really proving about the execution of the simulator up to outputting ri. And wi creates, in order to create messages in the wi, there is a polynomial blow up in the complexity of the statement it proves. Therefore, generating the wi is a polynomial in the time for the simulator to output ri. Okay? Huh. So now, polynomial is very bad. Even if it's linear, it's still bad. Because already, as you see, there is a recursion through this recursive equation. The running time is going to explode very fast. In some sense, that this is really kind of an analog of the black box exponential time simulation. And the problem, one problem here is that if you really think about it, the fact that every wi is effectively proving about the generation of previous wi's, okay, internally. And this is very bad, because every time there's a polynomial blow up, and it soon goes out of hand. So again, that's the first reaction many people saw this is that, what if I can have a wi that only have additive overhead? Okay, instead of polynomial in the complexity, maybe I can have something that's a polynomial in a fixed polynomial running time. That's of course very ideal, because if it's a polynomial in n, then the running time doesn't blow up. That would be great. But obviously, this seems to be like too good to hope for. It can't be that generating a statement could be in time independent of its complexity. However, we actually sort of managed to achieve the same effect by modifying the whole protocol together, in particular, leveraging unique P certificate. Okay, so what we're going to do is that we're modifying the protocol. In particular, we will modify how the trapdoor is set up. Okay? We're still going to follow the basic form, which is the machine on some input needs to output the random challenge. This is the same as in Barak, except that instead of proving directly that this computation is true in the WI, we're going to require the prover to provide a P certificate as a part of the witness, and to let the P certificate prove that this computation is true. In other words, inside the WI, all what you need to do is to verify this P certificate. And the verification of a P certificate, as we require, is very efficient. Therefore, now suddenly that to generate this WI, it becomes cheap. It becomes additive overhead rather than polynomial blow up. But this is very suspicious, right? Because it seems like I'm just shifting one problem from one place to another place, because after all, I still have to prove about the computation of M. And if not in WI, it is in the generation of the P certificate, right? And it could totally be that the simulator, in order to create those certificates, there will be an exponential blow up in the generation of the P certificates. This is indeed a very good question. And that's why there is also this second modification. Okay? Definitely, I do not want the simulation to have to generate a P certificate that's about the generation of previous P certificate. Then the time needed will explode very fast. So what we're going to do is that we will actually allow the machine to take a very, very long input. And this long input is a list of P certificates themselves. Okay? And each of those P certificates is about the correctness of the partial computation of this machine M. In particular, the ith one is going to prove that the machine M on the first I minus one P certificate will output some message in the ith step. Okay, fine. What is this purpose of supplying this long list of P certificates as input? The purpose here is that so that my machine M can use P certificate internally for free. Okay? Therefore, if I want to prove about the running time of the machine, it doesn't include the generation time for the P certificate, because the machine gets them for free. Okay? This is a way to get around the recursive proving about the generation of proofs. Yes? Yeah.
Its input is law.
Its input is law. Exactly. So what's going on? There must be somewhere that is going to go wrong, right? If the machine has a very long input, then as we said that, this is a problem because it is not hard for a cheating prover to commit to a machine that take a very long input to predict the challenge of the verifier. I can tell you one, which is commit to a machine that outputs its input. And later, this machine, if it's able to take a very long input, can just take the random challenge himself, which will output the random challenge itself. Therefore, everybody can come up with a fake witness. That is very true. And here's why. The reason we can do it here, allowing the input to be arbitrary length, is because of the uniqueness of the P certificate. Why? Because if you think about it inductively, I can actually prove to you that given machine M, the list of input he can take is determined. In other words, at the time when the cheating prover commits to the machine M, he might be committing to zero or committing to some garbage machine, he has already committed to the list of input. Therefore, that long list of input does not help him to predict the random string R. So why is this list of P certificates unique given M? Let's think about the first one. Okay? The first one is pi 1. And the pi 1 is a proof that shows that the machine M on no previous P certificate, therefore no input, is going to output some message. Okay? The statement that machine on no input is going to output the first message is unique given M. Therefore, by the uniqueness of the P certificate, the proof that certifies this statement is also unique given M. Because the proof is determined by the statement.
So, sorry, I'm going back to the question.
Yeah.
So, you construct concurrent zero knowledge proofs, yes? But let me relax the requirement and try to construct concurrent zero knowledge arguments.
It's always arguments. We're using collision.
Right, excuse me. Yeah. Right, exactly. So I'm going back to the uniqueness. Why do I care that there's another pi, another proof, but as long as it's hard to find it, I'm fine. Let's say there's a unique proof that's kind of easy to find, and then for analysis, take a correct statement. Okay? So for any person who has a unique proof, you can find it But then one can come up with other proofs, but you need to break out collision resistant hash to find it. I'm just, so let me add the same thing, but also if you break a one-way function or break something, it's also nothing breaks down because the prover can't do it anyway.
Mm-hmm. So you're saying that if
I need a proof.
Yeah, but it's always a proof of knowledge. I get what you're saying. You're saying that if those proofs are computationally unique,
yeah.
Right, instead of absolutely unique,
yeah.
Then why it doesn't help us to...
I think that's much weaker assumption, and maybe you can get another one.
That's a good question. I don't have it on top of my mind, but I need to think a little bit about it. Yeah. There are definitely those.
So which part is the WI or the P certificate?
WI is a proof of knowledge. P certificate is not a proof of knowledge.
You have to recover all the
prototypes. So okay, let it be. Then I just assume collision is the hash function to be super-polynomial hard. You can recover. If you think about universal arguments, you can recover the long witness.
But in this case, the witness for the WI is just a certificate.
Yeah.
How do you recover from the certificate? Can you recover the P certificate?
But the p-surfic doesn't have any witness. What are you trying to extract from it? The p-surfic only has a statement, right? And the statement, is extractable. You, as long as you can extract from wi, you can extract statement together with the p-certificate. It might work, yeah. There are some works that actually uses computationally assumption in together with the machine M that allows the machine to get something that's only computationally unique. Yeah. Okay. No problem. All right, so the point is that P certificates are unique given the statement. So whenever the P certificate is proving about the partial computation of the machine M, and each of the P certificate the machine M could ever receive is also unique, inductively proven by the previous statement it's trying to prove. Okay, so I sort of went through that why pi 1 could be unique. Then just think about if pi 1 is unique, then pi 2 will be unique too, because pi 2 is certifying that the machine M on input pi 1 is going to output a message. And since pi 1 is unique, machine M is unique, therefore now, again, by the uniqueness of the P certificate, pi 2 will be unique. Therefore, inductively, you can really show that this whole list of input P certificate and the output of a machine is really uniquely defined by this machine M. And hence, at the moment that you commit to the machine M, you effectively already or unconditionally have already committed to all the input. Hence, even if the input is very long, it doesn't bother the fact that the machine cannot predict the random stream. You can think about it easily according also again to the entropy argument, because in order for the machine to predict this high entropy random stream, it needs to get something high entropy as input. And if the whole list of input P certificate is unique given M, he's not getting any entropy from anywhere. Therefore, he cannot predict this random stream. Okay. To be more concrete, let us now take a look about how can simulation be actually done, and in fact, how do we set up this machine M in the simulation? Okay? As I said, this machine M is going to be a machine that takes a lot of P certificate as input. Okay? Therefore, we're going to separate this simulation into two parts, S1 and S2. S1 is a machine that takes indeed P certificate as input from S2, and it simulates the rest of the prover messages for the verifier. Okay? And in particular, S1 is going to use this idea of committing to the simulator's own code by committing to himself and together with the verifier. Okay? And every time when he needs to prove using a WI, well, he has already received the corresponding P certificate as input. Therefore, he can just create the WI really efficiently. Okay? And where does those P certificate come from? This P certificate comes from S2. S2 is the other part that sort of monitors the execution between S1 and V, and every moment at due time generates a P certificate by running in time polynomial in S1 and send it to S1. Okay. So let's see that if this method indeed kind of circumvents the exponential time blow up. Let's again take a look at what is the running. So let's first analyze the running time of S1. Okay? S1, up to outputting the message R1, he needs to run in time, of course, up to outputting the challenge Ri plus 1, needs to run first in time up to outputting the challenge Ri, together with time for generating the WI. Okay? Again, for generating the WI. But now, the WIs are extremely easy to generate. Why? Because if we go back, all those WIs are about certifying P certificates. Okay? It's only about verifying whether P certificates are correct or not. And the verification is cheap, as we know. Therefore, now, effectively, this wi has become with only additive overhead as we wanted before. Therefore, the running time of S1 is always bounded. And now, on top of that, if the running time of S1 is always bounded, every time generating a P certificate for it about its computation is also bounded. Therefore, the running time of S2 is also bounded. And I want to point out again, right? Here, indeed, it's very important that those P certificate that S2 is generating never internally prove about the generation of previous P certificates. Because every time S2 generates P certificate, it's about the execution of S1 on those previous P certificate as inputs. And that avoids the exponential blow up. And importantly, the reason that, again, we can afford to supply all those P certificates as input is because they're unique. Yeah, that's for soundness. Okay. All right, that's great. Then how can we relax this? Obviously, unique P certificate is very, very strong. How much time do I have? Am I already over time? Yes. Okay, there are maybe two or three slides left, so I'm going to do it fast. Okay. So relaxing it. First of all, we want to go to the CRS model. So the straightforward idea is just to say that let the verifier compute the CRS, which is a short and nice independent of the statement. And then afterwards, the trapdoor is going to be always, the trapdoor is still about verifying P certificates, but now it's going to about verifying the P certificates also with respect to the CRS in the appropriate session. Okay? So that's not too bad, but except that there's one problem, is that this way, actually, we will need the adaptive soundness from the P certificate. What it means is because the statement is really chosen after the CRS has already been generated. Okay? And in order to weaken adaptive soundness to static soundness, we're going to actually generate the CRS a bit later after maybe R is generated. And then additionally, we're going to give an extra round of WI argument to proof of knowledge of the statement before the CRS is generated, so that we can reduce down to static soundness afterwards. How can we deal with even weaker primitive, which is the two-round unique P certificate? Here, the difference is that the verifier's message in the CRS case is a CRS that's independent from the statement, but now it could depend on the statement in the two-round case. And furthermore, because it can depend on the statement, the computation time in order to compute the first message could be polynomial in the length of the statement. Unfortunately, this is something quite expensive, because if you think about it, the statement is going to about the computation of the simulation and the machine, which is the verifier themselves, which we don't have a bound, polynomial time bound about. We know that there are some polynomial, but they could be arbitrary polynomial. And therefore, I cannot let the verifier to generate this first message. He simply don't have the computation power. Cannot be done as a part of the protocol. But it doesn't matter, because it turns out that we can actually outsource the generation of the first verifier message to the prover. Okay? In particular, we can do so using FHE together with IO. The rough idea here is that one can just require the verifier to encrypt a seed for the randomness for generating the first verifier message. And then the prover could just use the actual statement, which is very long, and compute homomorphically the first verifier message. But of course, the verifier needs to help him to decrypt it. And he can't decrypt it just as is, because that might reveal the statement and violate zero knowledge. Therefore, we'll have to help the prover to decrypt it by using an IO program. OK, so that's roughly our say. and you can ask me more details afterwards. And it turns out that we can actually avoid the use of FHE by using a very particular construction of P certificate, leveraging the recent results of KLW. And therefore, we will get rid of the FHE. All right, so in summary, hopefully I convinced you today is that with unique P certificate, a very strong assumption, we can get a constant rank concurrent zero knowledge. Without it, then we can further weaken it into a two-round unique P certificate, and that we can actually show an instantiation using I/O. And the final statement that constant round the CZK is implied from I/O is perhaps not too surprising, given the light that I/O implies everything. It is somewhat surprising, but I/O also implies everything. I personally more like the part of the fact that how uniqueness could help simulation. Okay? Just because the messages are unique, suddenly one can get them for free. And that avoids the exponential blow up. And that's all. Thank you.